Vice President of Undergraduate Education at Torah College. And my task tonight is to introduce Dr. Henry or Hillel Abramson, who I think many of you in the audience know him better than you know me. But it's a great pleasure because this is a very meaningful occasion. It's an occasion in which we see Dr. Abramson as the scholar that he is, and as the Jewish thought leader, I think, that he is, in the sense that he has come out with a really meaningful book. I would call it a sefer. It's in English. We usually call that a book. But Dr. Abramson, firstly, has said that this book was written so as not to compromise his commitment to the mighty Avenue J campus, which you're presently sitting. He writes it before 6 a.m. in the morning, or from 6 a.m. until it's time to go on the Long Island Railroad. He gives an acknowledgement to the Long Island Railroad for his ability to use an iPad and to write a book which will be of historic import. The Sefer, the book, Torah from the Years of Wrath, 1939-1943, deals with the writings of a Hasidic leader, the Aish Kodesh of Klonimus Kalmish Shapira, who lived in Warsaw, experienced the depths of the Holocaust, and aside from writing various svarim, gave drushes, gave sermons every week as the Holocaust was unfolding. And although his writings have been studied, the insight of Dr. Abramson was to study how these weekly sermons coincided with the horrible events of the ghetto, of those experiences, and how we could correlate what the Rebbe was preaching, what the Rebbe was teaching, how he was living, how the Jews could understand what the Rebbe was trying to convey, and how he himself lived through those agonizing days. And that insight gives us great, I think, empathy, I think, with those who lived through that period. We had a great historian who taught for Torah, who was the chair of our history department, Dr. Monty Penkower. Some of you who are here, I see the faculty, some of you might have known him. He lives now in Israel. And he wrote many very meaningful books on the Holocaust, one of them called The Jews Were Expendable, which is a history of that period. I once asked him, how did you accomplish to write such great historic works? And he told me, he said, you don't understand. In my house, it's 1942. And that was what he told me. He had lived through that period. Reading through this sefer, this book, this Torah of the Years of Wrath, 1939 through 1943, you are moved back to that period. You are living in 1939. You're living in 1943. And you're thinking and hearing Torah, how did those people survive and what did they hear? And it's a challenge. Dr. Abramson has done it in a very marvelous fashion. Perhaps I'll leave you with one example, so as because he's the speaker, not myself. There was a period when they started to build the Warsaw Ghetto. And the drasha, the speech, was on a Rashi. Rashi is timeless. It's not pegged to 1939 or 2017. Rashi is eternal, and Torah is eternal. And he spoke of a Rashi about when a building, a house, a bias, has a plague, and the walls have to be torn down. And the person living in the house says, Kanega nirali babayas, a plague seems to be in the house. And the Rebbe himself says, of course, Rashi tells us, when you tear down the walls, you'll find there's a treasure there. And here he's talking to his congregants, his Hasidim, and they're building up the walls of the ghetto. They're trapping people. And he's trying to tell them, well, you can't always know what the future brings. Perhaps these walls will have a treasure in them. But of course, there is no treasure, but the message of Torah, the message which is in the Sefer, in the book, Torah from the Years of Wrath, contains itself nuggets of treasure, nuggets of what we call bitachon, faith, which all of us can take with us. And that perhaps is the ultimate treasure that we find in those, and the solace we find in those years. I'd like to call on Dr. Abramson.
Thank you, Dean Boylan. I appreciate the kind words very much. It's too bad it's a good thing we're taping it. I'll be able to use it next time I want a budget increase or something like that. This is a collective celebration. This is, it's true, my name is on the cover of the book because I pulled it together, but in many ways this is a celebration that marks the collective achievement of perhaps hundreds of people, many of whom are sitting in this room, who have contributed in one way or another to the completion of what is a personal milestone for me. I'd like to take just a couple of minutes to thank those people before we get to the material itself. I hope you'll bear with me. First of all, I'd very much like to thank Rabbi Moshe Weinberger from Congregation Aish Kodesh in Woodmere, who is perhaps the world's greatest proponent of Piyaseshna Hasidim. He wrote a very kind haskama that you'll find at the beginning of the book, an approbation, in which he said that this book has been on his desk for 40 years, and as he... The text goes on to talk about the insights that my book, God willing, has helped him with. Secondly, I'd like to thank Rabbi Moshe Teitelbaum and Rabbi Yaakov Trump, who lead the congregation where I personally express myself to God, and they've also written haskamas for me. I'd like to thank, in particular, the Joseph family. We're still waiting for a few members to show up, in particular, Charles Joseph, who is a very dedicated student of history, quite an astute observer, in particular of historiography and the Crusades of the 11th century. They helped out at a very key point in the publication process with subvention that made it possible to produce this work. And also the Rottenbergs, you'll notice they're, even though they're guests of honor, they're not sitting in the very front row because they have their own special seats. They like to sit in the back. And Livia in particular likes to ask hard questions. So they also helped out very significantly when the book was at a critical stage. I'd like to thank Dean Boylan, Mr. Mayor Weiss, for producing some fantastic observations on the cover. The cover is really his design after several months of very hard work and thinking about the content of the book. And we may, at the end of this presentation, have a chance to talk a little bit about what the design actually means, because there is quite a bit of significance to it. Mr. Marco Dashev, who took a fantastic photograph to put on the back cover, and Ms. Jamie Venezia, who is my able assistant, who so wonderfully prepared all of these things for us today. Could you please give Ms. Venezia a hand? Thank you very much for everything, Jamie. And then finally, a few readers of early versions of the text. Ms. Emily Jane Cohen of Stanford University offered some incredibly useful, salient criticisms. Rabbi Pesach Sommer, who's in the audience, Rabbi Sommer, put up your hand there. We shall give some acknowledgments. A well-known Rav and teacher of youth, and also a figure in the cyberspace. He's a very well-read blogger. And Rabbi Yoel Rubin, also in the back of the shtiebel. Rabbi Rubin, put your hand up, say hello. Thank you to Rabbi Rubin for his very salient and useful comments. And finally, Ms. Meira Beitler, one of my undergraduate students who read through the entire manuscript and offered some useful comments. Also, many of my family members who I won't single out, but they also read it and helped out. Now, since this is a book launch and not necessarily a lecture, I have to say just a little bit more about the construction of the book, because that's part of the personal story involved. I have to thank a few teachers and colleagues in particular. In many ways, this book began in 1983, December of 1983, when I was a first-year undergraduate student in the Jewish philosophy classroom of Professor Emil Fackenheim. I was not perhaps the best undergraduate student. My marks were kind of all over the place, but he found a way to touch a chord in my soul that inspired me to write on the Holocaust. And I just reread, I pulled this paper out earlier today and I reread it. It's actually pretty good. But he wrote on the back, you know, and he has this kind of like Old Testament look. He has a heavy German accent. He's a Holocaust survivor. And when he wrote on my paper, "You must publish," my life was changed by those three words. And I take that as an inspiration that I should try very hard to reach to my students with the same level of enthusiasm that could propel them onto levels of scholarly and personal achievement. This is, by the way, a picture of me in 1983. This is me receiving a letter that was a scholarship award to go study with Professor Fackenheim at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. It may be hard to recognize me because my face is quite obscured by the top of my face is hidden by a lot of hair, and the rest of my face is kind of all covered by the 1980s. But that's me at Kibbutz Chorshim receiving my notice of the scholarship, and I was extremely proud to study with Professor Fackenheim. We ended up having a falling out, which is a significant story into itself, but will take us far afield of our topic tonight. And I ended up 10 years later studying again in Jerusalem, but this time at a very different institution, at Yeshivas Or Sameach. And I had the unique privilege of studying at the kitchen table of Rabbi Nachman Bolman, who was the Mashkiach of Yeshivas Or Sameach. He pulled a few Talmidim out of the Beis Medrash, and he would bring us back to his apartment to study the Piasechna Rabbi, his Chovas HaTalmidim, specifically the last three essays there. It's very Kabbalistic essays, which were way over our head. But just being in his kitchen, listening to his sonorous voice, wearing his silk kaftan, the smells of his wife's kitchen wafting in from into the room, it was a tremendous experience. I don't think I retained 1% of what we said in that room, but I do remember the smell. And that's a very important thing for me. So between the two of them, Professor Fackenheim with a rather antinomian approach to the Holocaust, anti-theotic position on the Holocaust, and Rabbi Bolman with his very strong, fiery Bren for Hasidus, the two figures really shaped my soul towards the direction of this book. One small interlude, I had been writing this book for about 10 years, and I had a 500-page manuscript that was ready to go when I went to present on my research at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum in a special conference on ghettos during the Holocaust. And I met with Professor Gershon Greenberg, who is one of the most well-known experts in Holocaust theology. And he said, "Oh, Henry Abramson, I see you're doing good work on the Piasechna Rebbe. That's fantastic. Here, maybe you'll find this useful." And he handed me a sheaf of photocopies from the microfilmed manuscript of the Aish Kodesh, which first I looked at and I said, "Oh, isn't this interesting? This is the actual handwritten version, not the printed version which I've been working with." And then I had this sinking feeling as I flipped through the pages and I saw that the manuscript was quite different from the printed text. There were strikeouts, deletions, footnotes, and I realized that all of my work was for naught, and at tremendous personal spiritual expense, I had to set aside a 500-page manuscript and start all over again. Then I met, thankfully, when I was working through it, I met Professor Daniel Reiser, who had done exactly that work that I had to do of going through each page by page, and thankfully, he was almost finished. So I got to look at a pre-publication version of his amazing two-volume work, which essentially presents on one side the actual Ksav Yad, the manuscript of the Aish Kodesh, the original work, which, by the way, the term Aish Kodesh, title Aish Kodesh, was not the Rebbe's title. It was the title of his later editors, his literary executors, and it has kind of a snappy feel to it, Aish Kodesh, holy fire, but he never uses that phrase anywhere in the book. The actual phrase that he uses is Chidushei Torah Mishnos HaZa'am, which is variously translated as Torah from the years of wrath. But the term Aish Kodesh has become inseparable from the Rebbe, so that's how he's often referred to. At any rate, these are people I have to thank deeply for the research that has resulted in this book, and now I'd like, with your permission, to go straight to the material itself. The story of the Pious Eshin Rebbe is amazing in itself. It's truly inspirational. He was a well-known Hasidic rabbi, very active in the 1920s and 1930s, and he found himself behind enemy lines with the outset of World War I and trapped in the Warsaw Ghetto. Even though he had been offered many times opportunities to flee the ghetto, including offers from the American Joint Distribution Committee, from the resistance, the Jewish resistance, the underground, he nevertheless consistently refused right up to the very end, till his martyrdom in November of 1943. His Yahrzeit, by the way, was just this past Wednesday. He refused always to leave his Hasidim. As we shall see, he maintained a rescue pact in which he said to his would-be rescuers that you either take all of us out or none of us, meaning he would not leave. So towards the, somewhere throughout the beginning of the war, his writings came to the attention of the great historian Emanuel Ringelblum, who is truly a role model for so many of us in the discipline of history. Emanuel Ringelblum, who had made his career on chronicling the beginnings of Warsaw Jewry, dedicated himself to chronicling its destruction. And he assembled a secret organization called Oneg Shabbos, the Joy of Shabbos, and he sent out hundreds of people called Zamlers, or collectors, who would go out and collect data for future historians to be able to reconstruct the world of the ghetto. They operated in secrecy, they operated in cells where most of them did not know each other because they were worried that they would be discovered. And he had in particular one individual, Shimon Huberbahn, this is actually his Nazi registration card, who was a rabbi and a cousin of the Pious Eshin Rebbe. So the Rabbi Shimon Huberbahn, who he also left behind a tremendous, very sophisticated manuscript, which has been published in English under the title Kiddush Hashem, he chronicled the life of religious Jewry in Warsaw, and he collected the Rebbe's writings and eventually had them handed over through another associate for burial. The Rebbe wrote in January of 1943 his last will and testament, in which he hoped that if his writings should ever be found, they would be forwarded to his family living in Israel, and then they would be published. This is, in fact, his cover letter, the last thing he wrote. And then they were entombed underground in a series of containers. These containers here are metal file boxes from the first cache. They were discovered in 1946. I'll show you a picture of that in a second. And these are milk containers made out of tin that were discovered only in 1950. The 1946 discovery was a cause for tremendous celebration, but the documents were very badly damaged by moisture and were hardly usable. The other cache, which was held secret because the cells didn't communicate with each other, was unknown, and it was only in 1950 when a Polish construction worker was clearing the rubble of the ghetto for a construction project that they found the milk container that held the Rebbe's writings. There was a third cache that is still unaccounted for. Perhaps in the future we may discover it and we'll learn much more about the life in the ghetto. At any rate, the Polish construction worker handed the milk container with the writings over to the Jewish Historical Institute, and they languished there in Polish bureaucracy until the late 1950s, when this man, Boruch Duv Devani, who was a direct descendant of Rabbi Elimelech of Lizhensk, ironically a distant cousin to the Piasecian Rebbe himself, had been sent to Warsaw with the explicit request to find these writings. And he went to the Jewish Historical Institute, and after poring through all of the holdings that they had, he eventually identified them, and in fact, the microfilms were brought back to Israel, and they're published under the title Holy Fire. So the story of their discovering is nothing short of miraculous into itself. Before we actually address what are in the writings, let me give you a little bit of a background as to what is Piasecna Hasidus, what is the essence of this particular movement, which is a branch of the Grodzisk dynasty. So here's a picture, an undated picture, probably from the 1920s when the Rebbe was a younger man. And we should realize that we really see the Yad Hashem, divine providence, or as my daughter would put it, HP, Hashkacha Pratit, divine providence, showing its hand, because this was no ordinary Rebbe. The Piasecian Rebbe was a person of phenomenal stature in the 1920s and 1930s. He led Warsaw's second biggest yeshiva, in itself a phenomenal achievement, and he had a widespread reputation as a pious individual, a very learned individual, and in fact there are stories where he had collaboration with local doctors who would actually fill prescriptions based on his say-so. They had a fairly broad secular knowledge, which was primarily the result of his being an autodidact. But he had global plans. He was not thinking locally about Warsaw. He was thinking about all of Europe and, in fact, all of the world. And he determined a plan for nothing short of the revitalization of Jewish life in Eastern Europe and beyond, because he felt that the Hasidic world in particular had become reified, had become ossified and stultified, that there was a tremendous amount of focus on petty dynastic rivalries, whose Rebbe, my Rebbe can beat up your Rebbe, so to speak. I just made that up right now. I thought it would be funny, but it didn't sound so funny. Right, my wife has given me that look, like, oh man. Okay, but no, that's the thing. He felt that it was all about costumes and all about petty, tiny details, and they're missing the point that so many Polish Jews were simply losing inspiration, that the fire had gone out of their Hasidic life, and he felt that it had to be brought back. And so he developed a plan, which we know about, again, by Hashkacha Pratis, and to a large degree, through Chabad Hasidus. The first part of the plan was the public part. He published this book in 1932, which became an instant classic. It has been republished many, many times, including in two English translations. It's called Chovas HaTalmidim, The Obligation of Students. It's an absolutely fantastic work, which is basically how to be a good 12-year-old. It's a book written for young people, saying essentially, listen, I know you want to go out and play ball, you want to have fun, you don't want to be a tzaddik right now, you don't want to be a Rebbe, you just want to hang out with your friends and things like that. But he says, know that you are prince in Israel, know that you have phenomenal responsibilities. And it's okay right now. Enjoy yourself. Play. That's what God wants from you. But you must go on to your great responsibilities. And you have to start now. And he gives a series of exercises, spiritual exercises, actual doable exercises. How do you become a great 12-year-old? They are incredibly memorable. For example, he talks about controlling anger. And he says, you know, you think that, you know, you get angry so fast and then you regret it. How is it possible to control your anger? He says, listen, it's not so hard. How do you stay in bed at night, for example? How did you learn not to fall out of bed? You remember when you were a baby, right? Your parents put you in a crib, then they put you in a bed with rails, and that was because you couldn't control yourself. But now, even unconsciously, you may keep yourself in the middle of the bed. So too, you can control your anger. You can find that same space where you know, this is too far, I don't go over the edge. And he gives all kinds of actual physical descriptions how to do so. The essence of it is a technique of profound visualization. He describes a series of, sort of spiritual imaginations where one imagines one that one is leaving Egypt or one is visiting the Holy Temple, all kinds of things that are designed to sort of spark and inspire kind of an enthusiasm for Judaism. And this is essentially the first part of a multi-volume series that he planned to publish, and we actually amazingly have several subsequent volumes which were included in the milk jug. So we have the book that's essentially written for 16-year-olds and a book that's written for 22-year-olds. And believe me, I'm still trying to catch up with the 12-year-old, but the stuff on the 16, the 18, the 22-year-old, it's absolutely phenomenal. He some of the descriptions, for example, and my friends, I do not recommend you do this at home, but for example, he says on Yom Kippur, when you're trying to do tshuva, when you're trying to repent, imagine the day of your death. Imagine what it's like, you know, when the people come to your door and they tell your family that you've passed away. Imagine how they cry. Imagine how they feel. And, you know, I did this one Yom Kippur, and I was wrecked for a month. It was absolutely flattening. But that's the kind of power that is packed into the Pious Eschen Rebbe's works. Now, we know that's the public plan. The secret plan was contained in a book of which only 12 copies were printed. One of them resides in the Chabad library in this very city, and he gave it only to his closest disciples. It was called B'nai Machshava Tova. After the war, his disciples asked the Ger Rebbe, which is a close Hasidic relationship, if it would be possible to publish these now that the Rebbe had passed on, and he agreed. So we have B'nai Machshava in print today. And essentially, this small book is a guide for how young families can create small, intense circles that will radiate holiness into an entire neighborhood and an entire city and an entire country. It goes through the same plan of you know, this intense visualization exercises. He goes through all kinds of personal things, how you should relate to each other and so on. But he also gives very practical advice on how often they should meet, who should be allowed into the club, who's not allowed into the club. Fascinating guidelines on essentially what looks a lot like the kollel system today. But I mean, you know, like kind of like the kollels that go out to, or maybe a better example would be the shluchim today, very much like what the Rebbe writes in B'nai Machshava Tova. So we know about his overall plan that way. So by the time you get to the end of the 1930s, he's a well-published author, well-known, regarded as an expert on child psychology, regarded as an expert in Hasidus, really at the peak of his career when the war breaks out. So now we should turn to what is so amazing about this work. As Dean Boylan has mentioned, he chronicles the Holocaust as it unfolds, as he's explaining it to his Hasidim. He met with them every week on Shalosh Shudos. He gave a drasha, a sermon based on that week's parsha, and then at the end of Shabbat, he would write down his notes, and these became the kernel of the book itself. One of the reasons why it has not been studied by historians is the fact that he does not mention any historical data directly in the work. He never mentions the word Nazi, never mentions the word German, never mentions, you know, the idea of the war that's going on. There's no historical fixed points in the book. It's very frustrating to try and figure out, you know, what do you make of this? And in fact, if you didn't know who and when it was written, you would easily think, well, this is like a really depressing 19th century Hasidic work. You wouldn't necessarily know it was written in the depths of the Warsaw Ghetto. But what I discovered, and this is, by the way, not my insight, I borrowed it from a graduate student named Yehudit Tedor Baumel, who wrote a graduate paper in Hebrew University in 1980. And it didn't go anywhere afterwards, but she basically said, you know, wouldn't it be interesting if we could correlate the sermons with what happened that week on a micro level, street by street. So I picked up the idea, and eventually this book is the result. So he uses, I discovered, Aesopian language, where he's based on the idea of Aesop's fables, meaning that when you hear Aesop's fables, it's a story about a fox and about grapes, about a hedgehog, about, you know, what the Gemara would call the stories of the washerwomen, but they hide much deeper truths, like the boy who called wolf, right? So you tell the story, there's this boy, and he says there was a wolf all the time, and nobody believed him, and then one day there was a wolf, and it was too late, the boy was eaten by the wolf, right? So that may be a story about boys and wolves, but there's a much deeper moral, and you have to be able to be sensitive to the Aesopian underlying themes to be able to understand it. Charles, we have a seat for you right up here. Please, come on in. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Joseph, who I mentioned earlier, very important person behind the publication of the book. So what I did was I started to work on decoding the text by understanding what was happening in the ghetto that week and trying to imagine myself as a participant in the ghetto and walking into the Rebbe's close study on 5 Zielna Street, and then listening to what he had to say and figuring it out for myself, suddenly it became clear that he was talking about the Holocaust virtually every single week. He was all about the Holocaust. It was all about the war. It was all about what was going on, and he was constantly digging deep within himself to give chizuk, to give encouragement to his congregation. When you study it in this light, you see it's a work of soaring heroism, a work of phenomenal spiritual creativity and genius, and something really one of the great creations, I think, of the 20th century. This is especially so after the death of his firstborn son, who died early on in the war. He experienced tremendous tragedy. As the story is well known, the war broke out on the 1st of September, and shortly thereafter, it was right around Rosh Hashanah, shortly thereafter, the Nazis engaged in horrible bombing. The Luftwaffe would go over the city night after night. 60,000 people were killed in a few days. A piece of shrapnel flew through a window and mortally wounded his son. He gathered his son up and ran around the city. They found a hospital for him to be treated, but the hospital was overflowing with victims, people in the hallways and so on. So he went out to try and find some doctor anywhere to bring back to the hospital. He left his daughter-in-law and her sister outside the hospital saying psalms, reciting Tehillim for the young man, and then another bombing run went overhead and killed both of the young women outside the hospital, and then the son himself died a few days later. The Rebbe did not give a drasha for a few weeks, and then when he came back, he delivered a drasha of phenomenal pathos and urgency that speaks to the depth of his personal appreciation of the tragedies of the Holocaust. So this is not something at arm's length for him. If we had more time, we would go into more detail, but in the book, of course, there's quite a bit of discussion. Dean Boylan stole my thunder. I was going to give the example of the building of the walls, but we'll skip past that. I'll give you one other. One of my best, thank you. Well, it's not mine, it's the Rebbe's. But I'll give you this one, which is actually my favorite. So in June of 1940, the Rebbe delivered a very powerful drasha on the report of the spies. You know the story, of course. The Jews are gathered outside Israel, and they're not sure, should they go in, should they come back? God had given them a promise, but nevertheless, they have this idea, why don't we send in a set of spies to check out the land? They'll come back and tell us, you know, what the lay of the land is, how militarily feasible it is for us to take it over. They come back, 10 of the spies offer a negative report. There's no way we can take it over. There are giants there, fortified cities, forget about it. Two of them, Joshua and Kalev, ignore them and say, let us go up. So the Rebbe writes, this is the quote from Kalev, let us go up and take it over, for we certainly can. Let us understand, the spies certainly spoke meaningfully and reasonably, but the nation is powerful and the cities are fortified, it's a quote. Why did Kalev not argue with them to rebut their rationale and their arguments? Instead, he simply said, Na'ale, let us go up. Such must be the faith of the Jew, not only when he sees an opening and path to his salvation, that is, that he reasonably believes, according to the course of natural events, that God will save him, and thereby he is strengthened, but also at the time when he does not see, heaven forbid, any reasonable opening through the course of natural events for his salvation, he must still believe that God will save him, and he is thereby strengthened in his faith and trust. On the contrary, at such a time, it is better that he not engage in intellectual convolutions to find some rationale and opening through natural means, since it is clear that he will not find one, and consequently, it is possible that his faith will be diminished. This diminution in his faith and trust in God might serve to prevent his salvation, heaven forbid. Rather, he must declare that it is all true, that the nation that lives there is in fact powerful. It is true that the cities are fortified. Nevertheless, I proclaim my faith in God, that God is beyond limitation of nature, that God will save us. Let us go up and take it over, beyond reason and beyond logic. Such faith and trust in God draws our salvation closer. Now, it's a very nice drasha, one might think in general, but if you realize the historical moment, that week, only a couple days before Shabbat, the Jews in the ghetto learned that Paris had finally fallen and that the Nazi Empire reached all the way to the English Channel. That for weeks they had been hoping, rumors flew through the ghetto, that Paris would resist, Paris would stand up, Paris would hold itself true, and eventually the Nazis would be beaten back. But at that moment, when it looked like all was lost, the Rebbe pointed to Kalev and said, hey, Kalev didn't even bother arguing about the rationale. He just simply said, if God promised it to us, we will win. A tremendous courage, a tremendous chizuk that the Rebbe is able to demonstrate at a time when all seemed lost. So this is the tenor of the book week after week after week. Now, this is, as you can imagine, an incredibly difficult exercise. And as you go through the 3 years of the Rebbe's writings, it is possible to see certain plateaus, certain general shifts of attitude. And a lot of scholars have made quite a bit of what these shifts mean from time to time. One thing that I'm concerned about, that we simply don't have the data to prove one way or another, is who was his audience? We have a very small number of third-person accounts that indicate that at least in 1940, he was drawing a couple hundred people to his Shavuos gatherings, meaning he had a very large following. But towards the end of the war, his drashot become much more complicated, much longer. The source bases become far more sophisticated, far more Kabbalistic. In the beginning of the war, it's basically Chumash Rashi, very straightforward source material that would be broadly accessible. But towards the end of the war, you wonder, is he speaking only to himself? Is anyone there with him at the Shalashis Drushes? I'll just give you one example of that, that somehow the Drushes become much more autobiographical. This is something that he wrote in late 1942. Late 1941. There are times when a person is confounded with himself, saying, am I not broken? Am I not in a continual state of grief? weeping from time to time. And how can I possibly study Torah? How can I draw the strength to delve deeply into Torah and Hasidic thought? There are also times that he strikes his heart saying, do I not have inner courage to strengthen myself and learn Torah despite my own suffering and the suffering of the Jewish people? And then he responds to himself, am I not broken? How many tears have I shed? And my entire life is afflicted and weakened. Such a person is confounded. Yet as we have discussed above, the Blessed One is found weeping in the inner chambers. And the one who forces himself and approaches God through Torah weeps there with the Holy One who is blessed and learns Torah with God. This is the distinction. With the tears and the anguish that the person suffers on his own over his personal woes, a person may become broken and descend to a point where he can no longer do anything. On the other hand, those tears which he sheds together with the Blessed One give him strength. He weeps and gains strength. He is broken and takes courage to learn Torah and serve God. It is only difficult for him to elevate himself from the suffering of the first and second time. When he takes courage and lifts his head up and grasps onto Torah and divine service, then he enters the inner chamber where the Holy One who is blessed may be found, and there he weeps and sobs together with God, as it were, and he even acquires the strength to study Torah and serve God. You get a sense of his personal movement, his personal anguish over the suffering of his people under these incredible circumstances. And we see a few epigraphic examples of this. Like, for example, this is his signature on the title page of the manuscript of Mavo Hasharim. And you can see that he's written his name on the top. It's kind of in his rather distinctive and cramped style, Kolodmus Kalmish, and he says son of his father, and says that. And at the bottom, this violently struck out section, Daniel Reiser was able to decipher it by using modern techniques and actually working with a document in situ in Warsaw, and it actually says underneath, of Beisdin Piasechno, the head of the Jewish court of the village of Piasechno. It's my belief that he scratched this out when he realized that all the Jews were killed and there was no more Piasechno for him to be Av Beisdin of. And the violence with which he obliterates his title is indicative of the inner anguish he's feeling. There are also some profound mysteries that we simply don't know. Perhaps in the future, when technology allows us, we'll be able to figure this out. This is the actual title page of the book itself. You can see he writes at the top, the Chidush Torah, Mishnos Azam, and he writes the years 1940, 1941, 1942. I titled my book 1943 because he continued to write emendations right up until January 43. He signs his name here, Kolonimus. It's on the front cover of the book. And then he added this patch, and we can't remove the patch to find out what's underneath it. It's very unusual to patch a piece of paper. It's true that paper may have been expensive and rare, but this is the original piece of paper that he used from 1939. You can see it has base hay at the very top, or Tafshin, sorry, at the very top, 1939, 1940. He scratched it out because it continued. We don't know what's under the patch. We don't know, as it were, what's really going on in his mind, but we do have the writings that he's left behind. The end of the story is as you would expect. In the spring of 1942, an escapee from the Chelmno concentration camp, a man named Weiner, made his way into the Warsaw ghetto, and he described to the underground, the Jewish underground, the resistance, what was actually happening to Jews in this death camp. And they recorded this report because they were worried about being discovered. They used a false name, Grojanowski, so it's called the Grojanowski count, even though his report, even though his name is Weiner, and they managed to smuggle it out to the West. And so in the spring of 1942, and it was published in the New York Times, we know what was happening in the Holocaust. It was pretty accurate. The deportations, the stripping of all goods, the shaving of the hair, the gas chambers, the whole thing. We knew it from the spring of 1942. And at that point, the Warsaw ghetto was thrown into an incredible panic. And yet the Rebbe continued to give drushos. The drushos after the Groyanovsky report are the most chilling episodes of pastoral writing that I can possibly imagine. As he describes in words that are hard to translate, you know, how can the universe continue to exist? Are we not flattened? Are we not destroyed? Should not the universe revert to tohu vavohu, to formless void? How can it continue? But he continued every week giving these drashos. And then on the commemoration of the holiday of Tisha B'Av, the Jews of Warsaw were gathered up, 6,000 per day, and taken to the Umschlagplatz, this place shown here by the railway station, where men and women were separated and then loaded onto trains and taken to the death camp of Treblinka. Several thousand remained in hiding. This would be the nucleus of the heroic but doomed rebellion a few months later. Several thousand, including the Rebbe, were allowed to remain in the ghetto because they had permits to work in slave labor industries. The Rebbe was assigned to work in the Schultz shoe factory. And we have a beautiful passage here. Rabbi Sommer, you'll appreciate this because this is one of your favorites, a passage from Hillel Seidman. He writes, "Now I am in Schultz's factory. I've come at the time when people are both hammering in nails and reciting Hoshanot prayers." It's from October 1942. "Here are gathered, thanks to one of the directors, Mr. Avraham Hendel, the elite of the Orthodox community, Hasidic masters, rabbis, scholars, religious community organizers, well-known Hasidim. Sitting beside the anvil for shoe repairing is the Koziglover Rav, Rabbi Yehuda Ari Firmer, once the dean of Yeshivas Chachmei Lublin. He is sitting here, but his spirit is sailing in other worlds. He continues his studies from memory, without interruption, his lips moving constantly. From time to time, he addresses a word to the Piasechna Rebbe, Rabbi Kolonimus Kalma Shapiro, the author of the Chovas HaTalmidim, who is sitting opposite him, and a subdued discussion on a Torah topic ensues. Talmudic and rabbinic quotations fly back and forth. Soon there appear on the anvil, or to be precise, on the minds and lips of these brilliant scholars, the words of Maimonides and Rivad, the author of the Tour, Ramah, earlier and later authorities. The atmosphere of the factory is filled with the opinions of eminent scholars. So who cares about the SS, the German overseers, the hunger, suffering, persecution, and fear of death? They are really sailing in the upper worlds. They're not sitting in a factory on Novolipli 46, but rather in the hall of the Sanhedrin." So the Rebbe lived a few more months in the Warsaw ghetto. We're not exactly sure when he was deported, possibly after the rebellion. We have no data. But he was taken to another labor camp called Travniki. And in November of 1943, in Operation Harvest Festival, the Nazis reacted to the wave of rebellions that were occurring at places like Sobibor, even at Auschwitz, and they decided to murder all of the Jews at Travniki, and the Rebbe was among them. As I mentioned earlier, he was among them by choice because the resistance had attempted to take him out from that camp as well. He assigned a mutual rescue pact with his followers, with his fellow prisoners, including, by the way, free thinkers, atheists. It didn't matter to him. He would not leave unless all of them could leave together. His legacy is profound. My small contribution is, I hope, something that will be meaningful, and I hope that it will propel more students to approach the words of the Piasechna Rebbe, to see the profundity of his thought and how many of the prescriptions that he prescribed for the 1930s are still very relevant to this day. And perhaps I will quote in closing my friend Rabbi Pesach, who described at a Farbrengen that we were at earlier this week at the Shtiebel, a very moving passage where he talked about how he was teaching the lowest shiur of the ninth grade at the high school that's affiliated with some other Jewish college in New York City. supposed to thank you for the laugh there, Alana. These were like, if I get it right, these were the students who were like the least motivated, forced to go to a Jewish school by their parents, no interest whatsoever in Yiddishkeit, and they called themselves, after the 1980s television series, the sweat hogs, meaning they were really the anti-students. And Rabbi Pesach struggled mightily to teach them the Gemara and Torah, Chumash, Nevi'im, but the only thing that really connected with them was Chovas HaTalmidim, a book written by this rabbi 70 years earlier. And one of the students came up to him and said, Rabbi, are you sure this was written in Poland in the 1930s? I think he's writing for me. Anyone who truly studies the words of the Pious Eshkol Rebbe will recognize that student as a fellow traveler. I'm deeply grateful for your endurance and your attention. I'm grateful to HaKadosh Baruch Hu to allow me to be at this moment and to share this work with you. I won't be able to take questions, but I'll be very happy to sign copies of the book. I hope that you all enjoy the rest of the food, and I hope that you take away from this evening something of value from the Pious Eshkol Rebbe. Thank you. We have an Avil here who needs to daven Marav as well, so if we can assemble a minion over on that wall, that would be excellent.